solstice, everybody. I want to thank everybody for attending this community event to advocate for medical marijuana patient rights in Washington State. I want to quickly point out some housekeeping. Restrooms are downstairs from the lobby. There's no smoking of anything allowed in the venue, obviously. And smokers that go outside are requested to stand 25 feet from the entrances. I want to thank Town Hall. What a beautiful venue. It's been great working with these folks. These folks are class act. It's been a real pleasure. The Town Hall Cafe is open for your convenience. The emergency exits are in the south and west stairways. Please keep the flash cameras kind of down to a minimum, even though it's pretty bright up here. I don't think it's going to be a big problem. This would be a great time to turn off your cell phone ringer. There is Wi-Fi available under Town Hall with no password necessary. The theme this afternoon is safe, affordable access for medical marijuana patients in Washington State. That might not mean the same thing to everybody, but all of our speakers today agree that patients will not be served by all of the recommendations that have been offered by the Washington State Liquor Control Work Group. You know, our community took some bruises in the last year. It's not a simple thing to undo decades, almost a century of unjust, illogical drug policy. Our community's been divided to some degree. And we're not miracle workers, but it's been a year since the implementation of I-502, and we're hoping that we can find some common ground on this issue of patients' rights. Or who knows, maybe we can sow a couple seeds of healing that can at least begin the process. At least that's one of our goals today. To include everybody, participants have been limited to 3 minutes each. That's not very much time. Want to make sure that everybody gets their time to speak. We're going to ask the speakers who can hang around to hang around for 20 or 30 minutes after the event today so that you can approach them individually off stage with your questions and comments and maybe have a little FaceTime if possible. I want to thank our sponsors, The Stranger Magazine, Normal of Washington State, World Famous Cannabis Farmers Market, Canna MLS, Center for the Study of Cannabis and Social Policy, Northwest Patient Resource Center, Cannabis Medical Dictionary, Deep Green, Real Legalization, Washington Cannabis Association, the Indoor Sun Shop, Washington Seed Bank, and of course, presented by Seattle Hempfest. We have a few speakers that were not able to make it. They're out of state, and they're going to attempt to call in. We hope that's going to work smoothly, so please be patient as we get that together. And our very first speaker today, and we're just going to blow through these speakers through the next couple hours. It's going to be kind of a main stage style meat grinder. We will start with Joanna McKee, then Ben Livingston, Dante Jones, Senator G. Cowells. Our first speaker, Joanna McKee, might have also been the first person to really establish medical marijuana in Western Washington. She's been a pioneer from the very beginning. Please give a warm hand to Joanna McKee.
Remember how we had the meetings and we got the papers in order? We found out that there was a study on the books that Senator Cowells had sponsored, and we were going to try and have that study worked on. Well, they didn't want to do that. Back then, as most of you remember, medical marijuana was something like outer terrestrials, something or other, because marijuana, oh, that's what you get. You sit around, smoke joints, you get high. No, it's something you use as a medicine. And nobody had any concept of where it was. We all got together. And we put on meetings, we put on groups of people out picketing the post office. We had people doing marches. We had the community response because of us going out and telling them what medical marijuana was. We had to go and tell Olympia, we're not talking about just getting high and playing records. We're talking about our life and whether we can survive or not. We went to all the local offices, and then we went to Olympia. Everyone thought we were stoned and didn't know what we were talking about. We picketed the federal building. Newspapers started writing about medical marijuana. We marched in the streets. We went to the people of Washington and told them what medical marijuana is. Once we had the medical aspects brought out, the suits came in and helped us write the first medical marijuana bill that was passed. And that bill had a rule in it about 15 plants. Medical marijuana became a valid reason for using marijuana. Then 502 happened, and somehow the suits descended. Many were the same as the people who had been helping us. All of them had good aspects, good reasons for it. But 502 has nothing whatsoever to do with medical marijuana. We passed medical marijuana years ago. We took care of all the technicalities. Medical marijuana and recreational marijuana is like beer and hard liquor or something. It's a completely different aspect of the marijuana plant. And recreational, I have nothing against recreational users. But we had already been through all this. We've had everything set into law. And it was not for three plants or three seedlings. Patients can't get along on a half a gram every couple of days, as you can recreationally. So take the money that they're making off of the marijuana, put it into research, put it into what people need to use as to help them heal them with the plant. We can't just forget that, okay, medical marijuana has become recreational marijuana, and everything's the same. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joanna McKee from the Green Cross. Literally one of the pioneers of medical marijuana in our state. We're going to move quickly along. Ben Livingston is with the Center for Legal Cannabis. Please give a warm hand for Ben Livingston.
Oh, is this on?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Got a couple props. This is from 1998.
So I was yard sign coordinator of Initiative 692, a law that I assume we all love, right? And I just want to use the example. So I love Joanna McKee, right? One of my favorite people. Passionate, dedicated, Some might even say stubborn, belligerent. Not sure if you know when Initiative 692 was initially filed. Joanna actually filed a competing initiative because she thought the law was imperfect. I want to use that example to basically suggest that progress is not a direct path. It's not a straight line forward. We meander forward, we zig, we zag. And sometimes our paths align more, and sometimes they diverge more. And one example Martin once gave at a meeting we were having, he had put a chair in the center of the circle. Imagine this lectern is a chair, or just a lectern. But this might be our goal, our shared goal, our common goal. But I might be on a completely different path towards it from you. We might be diametrically opposed, but we have the same goal. With such meandering paths, with such potentially opposite direction among us, I think it's important that we keep in mind that we need tolerance. We need a wide, inclusive boundary. We need to allow for more of us in the conversation, for more of us in our activism. And so there's three things that I beg of everyone in the cannabis movement, and those are positive intent in our heart, thoughtfulness in our action, and compassion in our words. We can't stop the great wheel of change, right? We can't stop forward movement. We can direct it. We can't put ourselves in front of change and hope to stop it. We have to remember that. We have to think, how can we direct this energy? And a lot of times they call it trying to grab a tiger by the tail. You can't control tigers by the tail, but you can direct energy from behind. And so that's my general request of everybody, is to focus positive, to keep that in your heart. If you have positive intent when you move forward, you will succeed eventually. And you will, for all of your transgressions against one another, we will be forgiven if we have positive intent. And so, again, there's a lot of differing opinions in our movement and a lot of divergent paths. But we need to remember at the end of the day that we have the same goal, and that we can build each other up, we can build this movement up, even if we don't necessarily agree fully with one another. So that's my message when we start legislative conversations for 2014. It's going to be an interesting, perhaps busy year, and especially perhaps legislatively. And I just beg that we keep that in mind moving forward in 2014, that we have the same goals and we need to work to free this plant, and more importantly, to free our people. So final thing I would be remiss not to mention, I threw a pot party a week or two ago at the Seattle Center. So this is the first time that this has really ever been permitted in the city on this sort of scale. And I thought it was an important argument to win. I'm not the best fundraiser, so I'm in the hole. But I got these cool posters that I was hoping to sell, and I didn't do so well at the party. So I stuck these down on the normal table. If anybody feels like making a sliding scale donation of 20 bucks or whatever, that would really help offset my argumentative costs. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben Livingston from the Center for Legal Cannabis. We're going to bring on Dante Jones from Brian Ambrosia. Give a hand.
Hello, Seattle, and hello, Washington, as well. I'm Dante Jones. Today, we stand amongst each other as patients, business owners, and recreational consumers, engaging in the greatest democratic process of all time. We have passed the legalization of cannabis. And we have come here today to talk about how to move forward while at the same time not leaving anyone behind or forcing anyone into prison. So how do we move forward? How do we keep patients' rights, safe access, and expand the recreational market? And we do that using democracy. Many people seem to be focusing on tax revenue and how the state can make money off of selling cannabis to consenting adults. But many people are glazing over the actual money maker itself, the industry. The jobs that will be created as we move into 2014 are going to grow exponentially because this legal industry has never existed before. Not only will there be an increase in agricultural jobs for the production and processing of this plant, but there will be retailing jobs created as well. More local jobs means more money spent within the community, which leads to a stronger, healthier community. But perhaps the most missed concept is the ancillary market, which will support not only the culture around cannabis, but will, in my opinion, be a larger source of revenue than the actual production, processing, and retailing of I-502. Thousands of jobs will be created by newly formed companies like Grow Ambrosia, a equipment and professional services group, providing education training the next group of marijuana engineers. Grow Ambrosia has already begun hiring and expanding their team with local Washington residents, all of whom are authorized patients. By opening the door to a legal market, patients can have the ability to find a legal job and hold benefits, a 401k, paid time off, and a plethora of other options that were never available in the black market or the underground marijuana economy. The creation of these jobs will boost the market to unseen levels. We will, in fact, be growing money on trees. But this requires the legislature to make a very important decision, and that is to remove cannabis from the Schedule I status and declare once and for all that cannabis does, in fact, have medicinal value. Prohibition has clearly failed, and that is why we are here today. To remove the rights and protections that medicinal cannabis patients currently have would be a step backwards. To expand the rights and protections that medical cannabis patients need would be progressive, humane, and the right thing to do. Thank you very much for listening and being a part of this process today. Have a good one.
Thank you to Dante Jones from Green Ambrosia. We'd like to ask Senator Colwell, Sean Denay, and State Attorney Pete Holmes to come to the back room. Next, I'm going to bring up Alex Cooley from Solstice and Chair of the CCSE. Please give a warm hand.
Speak to you today about some of the steps forward and what we're dealing with in regards to medical cannabis, not necessarily what I-502 brings to the state. My biggest concerns at this point in time are reliable, safe access, as well as patient cultivation. My biggest concerns are the proposed recommendations, as it is for many persons. First and foremost, for myself as a cultivator, as a business person, as well as a patient, my biggest concerns are with the recommendations of growth and possession. As described, it is to be 6 plants, 3 mature, 3 immature, and I am very much so about the math, and possession amounts of 3 ounces does not equate to an appropriate 60-day supply. As a perpetual cultivator, I know that with 3 flowering plants at one time, you can harvest 3 flowering plants in 2 months, which is a standard cycle, which will only yield a patient 9 ounces in their 60-day period, which is not a very far cry from what is currently allowed being 24 ounces, which some persons may even say is inappropriate and even low if you juice or you use infused products. What is even more of an egregious recommendation, given some people don't know how to do math and they don't know cultivation, and I understand that, is the taxes. These recommendations are to create a robust and regulated system, which I've been a proponent of my entire career. If we create a robust parallel or singular system, why is it we must tax patients with three tiers of 25% excise? It is completely inappropriate. Again, it goes back to the inability to do math. You can back out taxes. You can make sure that patients are not paying tax, as it is with any pharmaceutical or recommended drug by a physician. I am prescribed echinacea, other herbal drugs from Bastyr Center for Natural Health. I pay no taxes. It should be the same for medical cannabis. Like a medicine, we should treat it like a medicine, and that is no taxes. I have been a huge proponent of taxes. My career, I pay city, state, federal, every single tax I can pay just to make myself more legitimate. But we are in an era of legitimacy for the cannabis plant, so let's treat it legitimately if it is a medicine, which is no tax. Is something that I have been dealing with the Liquor Control Board on I-502 in general, but also understanding moving forward for transition, is that we have no appropriate way to transition current effective providers into whatever system may be regulated. There's a reason why Colorado allows medical persons first. So we need to understand a better transition program for current providers. The last is the next steps. There will be legislation based on these recommendations. It is our responsibility to put forth opposing regulation and opposing legislation in order to get an appropriately regulated system for medical cannabis patients, ones that they have truly deserved for such a long period of time, and we came so close to having in 2011. I thank all of you for all of your hard work, and I look forward to working with you in the coming legislative session and the coming years. Thank you so much.
Alex Cooley from Solstice in the CCSC. Now please give a warm Seattle welcome to our State Senator Gene Cowells.
Thank you, Vivian. I love that you had the idea to bring all these people together today. I will apologize in advance. I'm going to have to leave in a few minutes. My mother is at Virginia Mason, one block from here, and we don't know if she's going to come out of the hospital alive, so I'm heading back there, but she's lived a very long and very good life. She's also had intractable pain very severely for many, many years, but could not get past the stigma of using medical marijuana, so has not. I'm hoping that what we are able to achieve in this state will ensure that no one has to make that decision, because there will be no more stigma for using medical marijuana. That's a process, but I am amazed at how far we've come. I started working on this issue with Joanna McKee in 1995. I have had bills almost every year since then, and have tried very, very hard to ensure that legitimate, qualifying patients have access to a safe, reliable, secure source of their medicine. And that's what has been behind everything that I have done. I do know, however, that there is a lot of division in the medical marijuana communities, and I'm asking people to really do as Ben mentioned, to come together and not make assumptions that people are evil or do not have the best interest of patients at heart when they have maybe some different ideas about what the best approach is. As a public policy maker, I have to also look at what's politically possible and make all the advances we can, but to be realistic about it. We have a 60-day, very short legislative session coming up. There will be a wide array of bills, I am sure, starting off with repealing all the medical marijuana statute because people don't need that anymore because of our 502 stores. Now, I don't agree with that. I will be introducing legislation. I'm still working on it, but I do appreciate the recommendations for the most part that the Liquor Control Board came up with, not all of them, and I will have some differences in my legislation. I am pleased that they have now decided that home grows will be okay. I will have that in my legislation. And I also believe, though, that we should have some group grows, smaller than exists now, but some small group grows. And you will hear later on from Ryan Day, who is the father of a 5-year-old little boy who has epileptic seizures. And they have been able to find a relief from his little son through marijuana usage rather than through prescribed medication. And I want to do everything I can to make sure that his little boy is able to get the medication that benefits him. Now, he may not, I'm not sure, may not want to home grow. Many parents do not when there are children at home. So they do need a designated provider. They can benefit from small group grows because so much experimentation has taken place and will continue to take place to come up with the right therapeutic amounts for these patients. Why don't you hold the applause? I'm trying to hurry and get as much as I can, and I probably only have another minute. Some patients will want to go to the I-502 stores. They'll like the convenience, they'll like the quality control assurance, but I think what we need to do is have some of an endorsement or certification on those I-502 stores that do choose to provide the strains and variety of medical marijuana for the individuals who come in. And I think there should be a trained staff on board. And I do think as well that we need to address the issues of distance from schools and playgrounds and other areas. It's not realistic in the city of Seattle to only have 21 I-502 stores, and I'm looking at pursuing having medical-only I-502 stores be allowed and have extra amounts or extra stores, additional stores for those medical-only ones based on need in the local jurisdiction. And these would not have markings or signage, and I would like them to be able to be closer than 1,000 feet as one travels around freeways and around blocks, not as the crow flies. Based on the federal sentencing guidelines, rules that allow for, or that do not allow for medical marijuana or any such drug from schools and playgrounds, but not transit stations and other areas that are included in I-502. We have to get a federal waiver for that. I also believe that patients should have arrest protection as well as an affirmative defense retention. Arrest protection, if they are able to have their medical health professional place their name on, not a registry, we're working that out, but with the State Department of Health, where a patient authorization card would be provided to the patient, to the designated provider, which would allow that home growing to take place, which would allow a complete tax exemption from the excise tax at the I-502 stores, and which would allow full arrest protection. So these are some of the things that I am looking at. I appreciate all of the assistance that so many of you have provided to me. And just in closing again, let's keep our eye on what we can gain and what we can do in preserving the rights that we have now for patients. Let's not attack people for bringing up some ideas that may be a little different than what you might think is appropriate, or we could end up with nothing. Thank you very much.
Thank you to our state senator, Jim Powell. Allison Bigelow, John Novak, and Aaron Telly, please work your way to the backstage area. Now it gives me great pleasure to welcome you, Seattle City Attorney Pete Holmes.
Thanks, everyone. It's wonderful to be here. You know, this is precisely the kind of work that we need to do. Vivian, I appreciate you bringing the community together, because the job's not done, and we have to harness all of the energy, all of the passion that's in this room. You know, I want to echo what Senator Colwell said, as well as what Ben Livingston just said, that, you know, the enemy is outside this room. The enemy is outside this room. We are all the troops. You are the front line in a battle that's not over. And it's so, so critically important that we remember that. And so I want to echo their comments and then add a little bit of a reality check, just to remind you who the enemy is. The enemy of medical marijuana, the enemy of I-502, the enemy of basic human rights is the failed policy of prohibition. I hope that one day a pot party in Seattle Center is looked at for what it is. It's a beer garden. It's a wine tasting. It's not. And if I can put in a plug for Ben, please help him with the bankroll, because you know, he was a pioneer. We have to keep pushing the edge, that's for sure. But let's never ever lose sight of what the enemy is, and that's prohibition. And let me just tell you how prohibition can, I promise you, in a very short order, raise its ugly head again. First of all, if you're waiting for Congress to act, to modify the Controlled Substances Act, to reschedule marijuana, you're going to be waiting a long, long time. They can't even balance the budget. How is it going to happen? It may happen here in Washington State. We already have some cities, unlike Seattle, that have said, we want to ban not only 502 facilities, but medical marijuana facilities. The city of Kent, the city of Yakima, Pierce County. And how about right here in King County, the NIMBYs were out in force, and they got the King County Council to say, no processing plant in Redmond Ridge. That happened here in King County. And so if you want to spend time wondering who the enemy is, it's prohibition. It's losing the battle that we have won so far and recognizing that it's not over. What I want you to do is to think about how I-502 can be imperiled by division within the community, and how the proponents of prohibition are clamoring for that division to stay alive and to keep fighting. They want you to fight with each other. They want to be able to reassert prohibition. They want 502 to fail. You have a wonderful leader in Senator Jeannie Colwell. 502 is perfectly consistent with a separate licensing system for medical marijuana. Whatever remedies are fashioned in the legislature, work with your legislators, work with Senator Colwell. The city of Seattle has said very clearly, we simply want a state license. It doesn't have to be a 502 license. It can be a state license that's for medical marijuana. But in the meantime, I want to close with this, and I appreciate that the speakers were all asked to be pretty short and to the point, because it is so critically important that everyone remember the enemy is prohibition, and what we should be doing is going at that enemy on united fronts. And so, if the medical community can at the same time work with the legislature to see what kinds of licensing and regulations would be appropriate for the medical marijuana industry. At the same time, all of you authorized users, everyone that is a designated provider, look at a 502 license. We need to get medical facilities licensed too. 502 is perfectly compatible with a dedicated marijuana supply system. Look into that. Look into your options. Don't be shut out. We have asked, the City of Seattle has asked that the Liquor Control Board give medical marijuana preference in licensing. We know that they have far too few licenses designated across the state and especially in the City of Seattle. We're going to continue fighting to make sure that we meet both recreational and medical demand. But it is so important that no one in this room leave thinking that prohibition is a thing of the past. It is clamoring to come back. It is looking for division in the community. And unless we all pull together, they will get their wish. They will get the wish in the new year. So let's all pull together. Let's recognize the new freedoms that we've struck. And thank you for all of your efforts, all of the work that has been built upon, all of your decades of activism. And let's not stop now. Thank you.
That's our Seattle City Attorney, Pete Holmes. Shawn Denae is our next speaker. She's with the Coalition for Cannabis Standards and Ethics and the Washington Bud Company. Shawn Denae.
Solstice to everybody. I am Shawn Denae Eddy, and I am the chairperson for the Coalition for Cannabis Standards and Ethics Protect Medical Marijuana Committee. I reached out and contacted a lot of people from within other organizations to form this very tight, fast-working committee. And throughout all of our meetings and all of the note-taking, I realized that we did come to consensus on some common ground. And I'd like to discuss that common ground. One is, we need to enshrine home grows. We need to be able to grow our own cannabis. We also have to protect co-op cultivation. Because if we don't have home grows and we stifle the co-op cultivation, we will in essence be making thousands upon thousands of Washington citizens criminals because they're not going to stop growing. So then where are we on the war on drugs? We also agreed that those of us that want to commercially provide cannabis to patients, we want to be licensed. We want to be regulated. We want to be able to follow the federal guidelines so that we are protected. Right now, I grow medical cannabis under the collective garden model, as I'm sure many of you do. I don't feel protected growing and continuing in this day and age under that model. And if there's anybody here that does feel protected about that, raise your hands. I'd like to talk about that because what we really need is to be able to have laws that license us and regulate us and do it in such a way that we as business owners can pay fees to provide for that oversight rather than expect sin taxes paid by the patients to provide for it. So as business people, we can provide those fees so that we are at least revenue neutral, if not also revenue incoming to the state. We also agreed that we need to protect and retain affirmative defense, just like Senator Colwell's just mentioned and Pete Holmes. We also feel really strongly that the doctor-patient relationship needs to be honored. Doctors that prescribe medical cannabis need to have the flexibility to work with their patients and provide cannabis and prescribe it as they see fit, as their patients need. We just cannot let laws and rulemakers tighten up that intractable pain. I have Lyme disease. Lyme disease is not on the guidelines, but I have intractable pain and I have since 1968. And cannabis helps my quality of life, as I'm sure it does many of you in this room and thousands of people beyond these walls. We also agreed that there's been a lot of talk about registry. And we think that we need to have a study group. Rather than instilling a registry right away, let's see how 502 works, let's see what comes in the future, and let's put together a committee to study that so that we can do the right thing in the first step rather than having to backtrack. We also believe that we need civil protections. You should not lose your housing, and you should not be fired from your job for medical cannabis use. We need laws that protect us from that. We also believe that post-traumatic stress syndrome needs to be one of the qualifying conditions. We have way too many veterans that are coming home from war that cannabis could really help improve their quality of life. And we also believe that you should not be denied an organ transplant if you are a medical marijuana user. Who in this room knew Rick Smith? Who in this room knew Rick Smith? Rick Smith was the inspiration behind the suggested legislation that we have written and plan on introducing. Rick died of not being able to have a kidney transplant because he was a medical marijuana patient. He and several others. So we need to protect those very, very sick folks. And since he was the inspiration, we're calling this the Rick Smith Memorial Act that does address these points. And what we've done is we brought back a lot of the language that Governor Gregoire vetoed in 2011 out of fear. That language already passed the House, it already passed the Senate. So let's revive that protective language for those of us in this community and then also update it to the sensibilities that the federal government has just recently put out. To that end, we are having a Rick Smith Memorial Act fundraiser. We have aligned ourselves with the Americans for Safe Access Health Before Happy Hour campaign, which is dedicated solely to helping us put together legislation in for the 2014 session. It's happening after this event, beginning at 5 o'clock down at Delta 9, that's 1950 First Avenue. It's just down the street from the Dope Cup Awards, so it'll be a great place to commune. We've got some food, some beverages, some music, and you can donate. Some of you have donated online. You can donate at the door there. And finally, I come from the Black Hills of Dakota, you know, Rocky Raccoon territory. When there was a gold rush in the Black Hills, it brought in a lot of good players who wanted to build community. It also brought in a lot of ne'er-do-wells that wanted to take advantage. And in this green rush, we can expect the same thing to happen. So us, as a community, all together, we need to circle our wagons and protect each other's backs as we move forward into this new and exciting world. So, thank you very much, and I ask you to all assume best intentions from each other.
Thank you, Sean and A from the CCSE and Washington Bud Company. Our next speaker is Allison Bigelow with the Cannabis Research Collective. Good luck to Allison.
Involved with a collective garden for over 10 years. Our lawyer has advised us that as long as cannabis is federally illegal, do not sell it. We don't advertise, we just share expenses and take care of our sickest who cannot afford to pay their share. We've tested our medicine at analytical labs ever since they opened, and we've developed THC-rich and CBD-rich varieties. 11 of our CBD strains have less than 1% THC, the ingredient in cannabis that produces the high. These varieties are desired by parents with sick children as well as elderly patients. We also have developed strains that are a blend of THC and CBD, which are quite useful for pain, nausea, and seizures. And we have the higher THC varieties that help you sleep and kill intense pain. Which should I kill if I were told to only keep 3 of these strains? We've invested so much developing all of them, and each is unique for different conditions and symptoms. Our lawyer is a defense attorney and has been active for many years defending patients, often pro bono. He is a hero to many of us because of his work, and we rely on his opinion. When some cities and towns created dispensaries, he advised us not to join them and question their legality. We have maintained our status as a collective. We still don't sell cannabis. I know we have helped many sick people and we've made it less expensive while developing good medicinal strains and methods of ingestion. There are intelligent reasons not to license. I do want to be legal, but this isn't it. Business lawyers new to marijuana law are giving advice on starting cannabis businesses, but they must advise their client that they are breaking federal law and are at risk of forfeiture in prison. Our defense attorney cares about us and tells us, do not sell cannabis. He would hate to see us in prison. Until the laws change federally, I am not going to sell cannabis. I have freely given my knowledge, medicine, and my life to promote a healthier alternative for people. I know I represent many others who will not license while cannabis is federally prohibited. We are at an odd juncture. If collectives are told to stop and we don't, I'm afraid good people like me will be prosecuted and imprisoned at the expense of our state. Members could have their medicine seized, and strains that have been nurtured could be cut down and lost forever. In 1995, after reading The Emperor Wears No Clothes by Jack Herer, I dedicated my life to making people aware of the benefits of the cannabis plant. Hemp has remarkable benefits as food, fuel, fiber, medicine, sacrament, and as a healthier alternative to relax. Most people don't realize these issues are of the utmost importance for the health of our planet and its people. This spring, I would love to plant a field of CBD strains low in THC. I would be able to sell hemp seeds for food and stalks for fuel or building material, and I could give away the medicine for free. The only thing that stops me is our current law. Let's lead the way into the 21st century centered on intelligence, love, and compassion. Thank you.
Thank you, Allison Bigelow. Cannabis Research Collective. We're running a little behind, but everybody's saying great stuff, so we're just going to run this through. We've got a little buffer time at the end, so thanks for just hanging out and being patient with us. Our next speakers will be Aaron Paley, Dominic Holden, and Sean Green. Give it up to John Novak from 420 Leaks. John Novak.
Thank you for all being here today. My name is John Novak. I'm with 420 Leaks. 420 Leaks is a program that started through the Cannabis Action Coalition. I want to especially thank Steve Sarge and Arthur West for your inspiration behind 420 Leaks. If it wasn't for you guys, it would never have happened. All of you wouldn't have the information that you now have about what's going on with the Liquor Control Board, the Department of Health, and others. Unfortunately, the group behind this did not see fit to put Steve Sarge or Arthur West up on the stage. I would have gladly given my spot on their behalf. These gentlemen have been there, especially Steve, since these laws went into effect, and has been a bulldog ever since. Many of you may not get along with them, but if you want to have a community of voices, all voices need to be represented. Right now, we are dealing with a group in the Liquor Control Board, Department of Health, even in the governor's office, who are trying to kill medical cannabis. They're trying to get you to compromise on your rights, to compromise on my rights, by offering six plants, take away collective gardening. I want you all to know that I am what you would call a last line medical cannabis patient. If it's not, this is my last drug. If I'm not able to use this, my next step is experimental brain surgery. That's why this is such an important issue to me. And the fact that two of the most important voices that I've looked up to could be excluded from this process shows that maybe our hearts really aren't in the right place.
You're here.
If we want to move forward, these gentlemen need to be a part of it. I want to thank you all for your time. And I'm going to tell you, right here and now, I am against any changes to our medical cannabis laws. If you want to put up legislation, you're doing so at the risk of patients throughout the state. All the legislation that I've seen has been very Seattle-centric. The vast majority of people in this room are very Seattle-centric. We need to get out of ourselves, get out of our egos, and start thinking about the entire state. Everybody in this state. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, John Novak, for 420 Leaks. Our next speaker will be Aaron Telly, Seattle attorney. I want to say that Sean Green, Allison Holcomb, Sharon Whitson, and Oscar Velasco-Schmitz, please come up to the backstage area. Give it up to my friend, Seattle attorney, Aaron Telly.
This thing's all wrapped up. I'm used to walking around. I'm only used to talking to about 12 people at a time. I have a cold because my daughter consistently acts as the fourth horseman of the apocalypse, bringing every variation of the common cold to my home. And I do not wear a suit on Saturdays unless I have to. So I am here to talk to you guys about what's going on. I know part of the reason that we were brought here together had to do with community. It also had a lot to do with what we're facing. We're all rising up together for an occasion, finally, because we found a common enemy. Washington State Liquor Control Board wants to kill medical marijuana. This isn't thinly veiled contempt. They clearly want to put an end to it. And the new proposals are essentially making medical marijuana small enough so that they can drown it in a bathtub of 3 inches of water. And so what are we going to do? You have several different people coming up here. Each one has their own proposal. If you are looking for somebody on this stage to fix this problem, you have made a huge mistake. You are the criminal. You are the people that are going to stop this. If you do not rise to this occasion, then it will fail. They only have one person to listen to right now, Washington State Liquor Control Board. That is it. That's the only proposal on the table. Other people are coming up with other proposals. If you want to join them, fine. The truth is that as activists, we live in absolute truths. That means it's difficult for us to step out of our own shoes and look at the view of other people and try and incorporate those views to come to a conclusion. That's fine with me. That's fine. But do something. If you guys do not pick up the phone and call your legislators this session, one person represents about 100 people. 100 people represents 1,000, so on and so on. If you do not pick up your phone and call your legislator this session, you're failing. You're failing. If you expect us to do it, this is only about 20, 25 people coming up to talk. It's not enough. It has to be all of you. I always, every opportunity I get where I speak publicly, I like to have everybody hold up their telephone. So if you brought your cell phone, and I know there's more cell phones than people in here, so hold up your cell phone for me. All right, good. That's enough people to make me happy. Now you can type in this number, ready? 360-902, I'll go slow for those of you medicated. 360-902-4111. Did you guys get that?
What?
I'll do it one more time. 360, my old eyes, 902 4111. That's the governor's office. You guys give him a call. I can't give you his private cell, but please, feel free to give him a call too. He's not in today, so wait till Monday. Make sure he hears from you guys. Let him know. Again, you guys represent the people that put him in office. And when you talk to your legislative assistants, and you talk to your legislators, you remind them that medical marijuana, it polls better than recreational marijuana, and it polls better than Republicans, and it polls better than Democrats.
Thank you, Aaron. That's a great segue to our next guest speaker, surprise, Governor Jay Inslee. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. I want to mention Sean Green, Allison Holcomb, Sharon Whitson, Oscar Glasgow Schmitz. Please be in the back. Our next speaker is Dominic Holt for The Stranger Magazine, one of the sponsors of today's event. Give it up to Dominic Holt.
Hello, everybody. Really quickly, a round of applause for Vivian McPeak. A friend of mine has a 16-year-old niece, and she has been suffering with a chronic headache for years. Right now, this moment, the 16-year-old girl has a headache, and it prevents her from sleeping and from studying and from enjoying her life and doing all the normal stuff that a 16-year-old girl should be doing. And she's tried everything to make the pain stop. It doesn't stop, but cannabis helps. Cannabis helps a 16-year-old girl sleep and study and live her life. And I'll be the first to say that 16-year-olds should not be the people who are smoking marijuana. But I'll also say that 16-year-olds are not the people who should be living in constant pain. Right now, this girl can go to a medical cannabis cooperative in Washington State and obtain medicine that helps her, where the strains are tailored to her needs. But as Ben Livingston reported in The Stranger recently, and as everyone here knows, Governor Inslee's office and the State Liquor Control Board and several lawmakers, they want to shut down her access to her medicine by banning cultivation and cooperatives. They say that the recreational pot stores allowed under Initiative 502 will be sufficient. But when those stores open, this girl won't be able to obtain her medicine there because she's under 21. That's why we need to defend the medical cannabis law and allow home cultivation. But even then, that's not enough. It's absurd to suggest that this girl is going to grow pot in her parents' house. She needs a cooperative, and those need to remain legal too. That's the message they need to be. The I-502 stores that we are looking forward to, I am looking forward to, are inadequate for the patients who are most in need. And lawmakers are being opportunists here. They're attempting to use I-502 as an excuse to basically destroy the medical marijuana law. But that is not what we voted for. I was a strong, enthusiastic supporter of Initiative 502. But I never, and the voters did not vote to repeal the medical marijuana law. I-502 is supposed to make patients and recreational users alike safer and protect them from arrest. And I get that some folks want legalization to work and they're willing to make compromises, but they can't do it on the back of the sick and dying people. And they cannot do it on the back of 16-year-old girls who are in fun. I'm not gonna name any names here, but there are some people on our side who aren't going far enough to defend the medical marijuana law. And they're not defending cooperative cultivation and the dispensaries, the cooperatives, because in practice right now, our medical marijuana law does provide for these dispensaries, for these cooperatives. And for people like this girl in chronic pain, they're essential to her well-being. So that's why she needs to be protected. We worked so hard to pass I-502 that we can't afford to have the backers of I-502 not be the loudest voices defending the truth of the most important parts of the medical marijuana. We didn't work so hard so that we would make other people's lives difficult. Our medical law is imperfect enough as it is, and a step forward for legalization should not come at the expense of the suffering of other people like this girl. Thank you.
Dominic Holt from The Stranger Magazine. Our next speaker is Sean Green from Pacific Northwest Medical, Spokane Shoreline. Sean Green.
Sean Green, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank everyone for having me up here today. So I've been in the medical marijuana industry, out in the open, operating a retail store since 2011. And we come full circle to that now, to a complete legalization of recreational marijuana. Change is scary for everyone. But 15 years ago, if you were to so much as have a gram in your pocket or a brooch in your ashtray, you're going to prison. Today, you can have an ounce of marijuana, everyone over the age of 21. That was something we voted on as a society. Medical marijuana is something we also voted on separately. At what point in our lives were we told that if you choose this, you can no longer have this? That is unacceptable. No is an unacceptable answer. Change is inevitable. Each and every one of us have the power to influence in this time of change. This country was founded by men that refused to be ruled by tyranny. We have the freedom to shape this in any way we choose. So let's take this time of change and call our regulators, our legislators, and let them know what you're thinking. That is the only way that they're going to know. Thank you.
We're running a little late, but we're just going to keep slamming through it. Our next speaker is Allison Holcomb, ACLU Washington.
Thank you to everybody for being here, no matter what your position is, no matter what you think of me. And I'm going to take just a minute. For those of you who are newer faces, younger people, you probably don't realize that I'm probably older than a lot of you here. But I want to give you a little bit of my background personally. A lot of you have never met me. You've never talked to me. You've heard a lot about me from other people, but you don't actually know what's true. I started defending medical marijuana patients back in 1995 when I went to work for Jeff Steinberg. I was a little shocked to see Martin Martinez say in Seattle PI last month that Jeff was the one who defended him, when actually it was me, Martin, who took your case to trial. It was me who got at least 8 of the 12 people. We didn't get them all, but we got 8 of the 12 people to agree that his 88 plants that he was growing in his home were for his own personal use. I have represented providers who were threatened with federal prosecution if they didn't plead guilty to felony charges in state court. And those providers had to plead guilty on the day that their patient died because the patient's cannabis had been cut off. I have represented patients, providers, and commercial growers, smugglers from Canada, dealers, users. I was representing people charged with marijuana crimes, people who had their assets taken from them from the government for over a decade before going to work for the ACLU. I know what compassion looks like, but I also have a bullshit meter that has been finely honed by representing all the people that I've represented in the cannabis community. So that's where I'm coming from. And I also have a really strong record of being an effective advocate. You may hate me, but you can't ignore that when I started working with Senator Jeannie Colwells in 2007, we were able to start getting medical marijuana legislation passed in the legislature. I served on the I-75 panel, and I was actually able to sit down one-on-one with our former Seattle City Attorney, Tom Carr, and get a consensus report published that all 11 members of the panel agreed to, which said, hey, the sky didn't fall. And then, of course, there's 502. So I tell you all that not to say believe what I say or agree with what I say, but to at least acknowledge I know a little something about being an effective advocate, and I'm here honestly to give you my take on what you need to be thinking about if you want to be as effective as possible going into the 2014 session to talk about medical cannabis. The volunteers from Normal did me a huge favor and said they would pass out materials. I brought materials for you today because my comments need to be very short. In those materials are a couple of things that I think it's important for you to say. First of all, it's the actual backgrounder from the I-502 that says what we said about the medical marijuana law during the campaign. It was in writing, it's still on the website. I want you to have that so you can see what we were actually saying. The second thing that is in there is what we actually said, what the ACLU of Washington actually said to the Liquor Control Board about its draft recommendations, which is first and foremost, protect what Initiative 692 protected, which is patients growing for themselves and being able to defend themselves in court no matter how much marijuana they possess. Those are the two core protections that our medical marijuana law actually delivered. And in that letter, it's a long 7-page letter, you will see the actual history of the evolution of our medical marijuana law and what is actually legal now and what's not. The third thing that's in there is the actual final draft recommendations from the Liquor Control Board. That's available online, but I wanted to make sure that you saw what the final recommendations from the Liquor Control Board were to the legislature. And finally, there's a one-pager on the top that are my suggestions for what you ought to be doing when you're thinking about talking about medical marijuana to legislators and other policymakers in the upcoming session. First and foremost, focus on the basic patient rights. Those are the rights to grow for oneself so that you can grow whatever strains you want or to designate a provider to grow for you. Focus on that. Patients need to be able to grow their own medicine. And second, they need to be able to defend themselves in court regardless of how much marijuana they possessed. That is what our medical marijuana allows at its core. Second, recognize that engaging in commercial activity is very different from protecting patient rights. That is the key. I want to tell all of you right now that if you think the debate in the upcoming session is about medical versus recreational, you are missing the boat. What the debate is about is whether or not people are going to continue to be allowed to engage in commercial activity with no license, no regulation. And yes, they want to know whether or not you should be able to or be required to pay taxes. That's going to be part of the conversation, because guess what? If you're in business, that is part of the conversation. It doesn't matter what your business is. Second or third, think through what is really different about cannabis that's intended primarily for medical use and cannabis that's intended primarily for non-medical use. Think about what those differences actually are and whether or not those differences require laws to explain that difference or if it's really a matter of public education and marketing. For an example, if I'm drinking a glass of red wine every day for my heart health, is the wine any different if I'm drinking it because it makes my lasagna taste better? Those are the questions that people that aren't in the medical cannabis community have. What's the difference between the two? So focus on that and be able to explain that and articulate that. Also, a lot of you aren't understanding that if your cannabis product has less than 0.3% THC in it, it's not defined as marijuana under our Washington state law anymore. What that means is you can sell those products anywhere but an I-502 store. So if you've got your high CBD products that don't have THC in them, then why aren't you talking to your neighborhood co-op, herbalist, homeopathic store, your gas station? They can be sold anywhere. Urban Outfitter is selling products that have cannabis in them that has no THC. You could be doing that now. If you're worried about, I know, talk to your lawyer, maybe they don't get it. If you're worried about the prices, and that's a lot of what I hear, here's a few things, and you'll get this in the fact sheet, and I'm happy to email the fact sheet to anybody. Understand that the tax is not 75%. It winds up, with even retail sales tax being included, it's about 30 to 40% of the total tax. So understand that piece. Also, understand and acknowledge that current prices still include a prohibition risk premium. They're still higher than they're going to be in a legal competitive market. And if you really care about patients, focus on what is going to be the price that patients are going to pay, with or without the tax. If you want to argue tax exemption, like Alex said, that's great, but you better explain to legislators that that tax exemption is going to benefit the patients and not you. In other words, your prices are going to be 30 to 40% cheaper than the 502 prices. Otherwise, my bullshit meter goes off and I say, you just want to pocket the tax that everyone else has to pay, all right? Finally, hopefully this is coming through in all of my remarks. Do yourself a favor when you're talking to lawmakers and don't try to play the victim. I have heard frequently, it wasn't our fault that the governor vetoed Senate Bill 5073 and we don't have regulation of dispensaries. You're right, it wasn't your fault. However, you're responsible for opening a dispensary after the veto. It was a known risk. You decided to go into business despite the fact that the governor vetoed the licensing and regulation of that business. And in fact, Senator Colwell's introduced a bill 10 days after the veto that would have limited collective gardens to one per parcel and would have made it so that this collective garden safe access point business would clearly not have been legal. Nobody thought that collective gardens were supposed to replace dispensaries. So just acknowledge, you made the decision you wanted to go into business. Now you need to have a conversation as a professional, totally separate from patients need to be able to grow them for themselves. But keep that distinction in mind. There's business and there's compassion. In a good setting, they match up, but you need to be clear that it is two different things that you're talking about. Thank you very much, I appreciate it.
Thank you, Allison Holt of ACLU Washington. Our next speaker is a parent, a cancer survivor, and even though I play the director on TV, she runs most of the Hempfest. Sharon Whitson.
You know, the last year or so have been so hard in our community, and it's really come to light in my mind that how do you tear apart the cannabis legalization community? You put an initiative out there to legalize and you watch it implode upon itself, and that's what we've unfortunately had go on over the last year. Cannabis users are a minority of our society. If we break that minority down into further minorities, we're never going to get anywhere. We have to come together in unity because we all really do want the same things. We all need to feel empowered right now, and we need to begin contacting our legislators if we have not already, and we need to talk to them about why the current recommendations don't work. First of all, collective gardens. I'm married, my husband's a patient. If we both grow, isn't that a collective garden by default? Is one of us going to be denied our right as a patient to take care of ourselves? The other thing is the registry idea. You know, I'm here to tell you 4 years ago, I had a job that I was at for 12 years. I made the mistake of relaxing my HIPAA rights and letting them know I had cancer at a time that they were renegotiating their health care for the next year, and I found myself laid out off my job. If we create a registry, what's to say that those same type of things are not going to happen again? I mean, this is a HIPAA, this is a private relationship between you and your doctor, and it needs to stay that way. That's why we have HIPAA rights in place. So, you know, here I am, a living example of someone that was foolish and did not keep her HIPAA rights private and lost a job I had been at for 12 years right when I was beginning the fight of my life. I mean, it was just completely devastating. So we need to start contacting our state and our federal legislators and letting them know these types of issues and how we want them to correct the recommendations. It's really important to speak to exactly what's written and to give examples of how you want to see them change it and why you want to see them change it. Another good point is they're already worried about the supply under 502, that they might not have enough supply to meet the recreational demand. Well, where does that leave medical patients? If they can't supply enough for the rec market, that leaves people that truly need cannabis without it, and that's just simply not acceptable. I'm going to be brief and close with this. Community has been such a compassionate and loving community, and we need to keep in mind that we are a family. Families always disagree, but at the end of the day, we all do want the same thing, and that's to preserve medical cannabis for medical users here in Washington State. Thank you very much.
Our first speaker to actually keep it to 3 minutes. Thank you, Sharon. I should have known. Oscar Velasco Schmitz is not only a brand new father, but he's with Dockside Co-op. Give it up to Oscar Velasco Schmitz.
It's almost difficult to put into words being here before you in this singular moment where the thing that motivates us all being here in the same space and discussing the different themes and topics and feelings at a very fundamental level is cannabis. And even more fundamentally than that, it's the effect that this wonderful plant that has been around for eons, used for multitudes, it really is very difficult for me to put words together with this. So I'll say this. We stand at a point of opportunity, not only with cannabis, but with consciousness. How do we know? It's the things we hear. It's the things we feel. The things we smell. The things we touch. That's reality. This is an opportunity for us to question reality in all forms, in all propagandas. For the longest time, cannabis has been rendered a drug of useless experiment. And we know that not to be true. In fact, we know how much benefit it is. And when I say we know, I mean that we can actually feel, that we can actually think that it has an effect on us. To that effect, I'd like to put an idea into your minds. There's so much talk about economics and how to make money from this and how to gain power from this. But what is really lacking is compassion and true compassion that this plant offers. Think of what we can do if we can house knowledge. I'd like to put the idea into your minds that we can take some of the economic benefit from this plant and create a Washington State Medical Cannabis Research Institute. Because what is even more important than how this plant affects us is the idea of how this plant affects us.
Yes.
And I thank you for, I thank you as a person, Joanna McKee, for everything you do. I thank you, Steve Sarich, for everything you do. I thank you, Greta Carter, for everything you do. And I say these individuals so that you here at this moment in time realize that we are singular individuals with any number of condition, with any number of feeling. Anyway, I'm getting even deep for myself here. But I want to thank you all. That's all. I'm very heartened. I'm going to continue to do the things that I do. I know that you'll continue to do the things that you do. Everybody here that has spoken has such great ideas. So just listen to the ones that you think are great and go and do those things. Or more importantly, don't be afraid of your own ideas and of taking those ideas and turning them into reality. So anyway, I'm encouraged. Thank you for all you do.
Oscar Lasker speaks for Dockside Co-op. Next we'll bring up Brian Stone, Patient, and Cannabis Action Coalition.
Hi there, everybody. While I'm honored to speak on behalf of the Cannabis Action Coalition, I do so with some reservation, as our most articulate and active CAC members have been excluded today. They may not always play nice with others, like Mr. Novak and I are perceived of doing, but they are the ones that do the heavy lifting in our group. If it were not for the leadership and dedication of Steve Sarich and the political prowess of Arthur West, we would not have the benefits of the public records on 420 leaks. These documents prove that the curtailment of our rights was part of the plan long before the legislature passed the LCB to study how to bring medical marijuana under 502, or as we like to call it, kill patient rights. Freedom fighters are often reviled by their critics for their tactics, especially when they state the truth. Dr. King, Gandhi, Mandela, all were persecuted not only by the powers that be, but also by their political rivals. The proposed legislation is named in honor of Rick Smith. Rick and I worked together during 4 years with the Cannabis Defense Coalition. Rick was an outspoken opponent of I-502 and understood the legislative process well. And I have serious doubts that Rick would support the current efforts being led by Ms. Boyder, industry group CCSC, and Mr. Eichmeier. He understood that timing is everything in politics. When 5073 was on the governor's desk, we were told that the federal prosecutor was going to come after the state of Washington and the patient community. What we found out later was that the state law enforcement, WAPA, WASPIC, they dictated the conversation and their agenda held the day. But this same fear is now being spread of the federal boogeyman coming for us now if we do not bend to the will of the new prohibitionists and give up all our hard-fought rights. I have not been cowed by fear yet. I am not going to do it now. Neither will the Cannabis Action Coalition. How about you folks?
No.
Thank you. Any bill that contains a registry of any sort is going to never get the support of the Cannabis Action Coalition. So that's our first agenda point. We believe that patients have an existing law that covers medical cannabis. It's called 6951A. We advocate waiting for I-502 implementation before suggesting any changes to it. We advocate working on potential changes now to show that we are looking for thoughtful changes to discuss in 2015 after the current hysteria has ended. It is suicidal for the patient community to back any legislation in this upcoming session. The current Boyder and Eichmeier bills give overzealous legislators like Representative Chris Terce the opportunity to fully roll back our patient rights through amendments, strikers, and partial vetoes. It is Representative Hurst's stated goal to start the process of ending medical cannabis access now. Any bill that contains a registry, I'm going to say this one twice, will never get our backing. Every existing registry has been breached by the feds. There are no exceptions. Don't ask patients to put themselves at risk. Community leaders back the wait-and-see position, including National Board member and attorney Jeffrey Steinborn, and renowned national activist and my very good friend Ed Rosenthal. The CAC wants to get along and bring our community together as well. Together in freedom, not further restrictions. If you're asking us to do this, to give up our freedom, well then we will have a fractured community. But please join us in making it otherwise. Support patients, not 502 integration, LCB control, and questionable and untimely legislative efforts. Thank you for your time.
Our next speaker is Kevin Oliver from Washington Normal. Came all the way from Eastern Washington.
Thank you, Seattle Hempfest, for providing this forum to foster a united community and to set intentions moving forward into a new year. We have an awesome responsibility here right now to protect the destiny of medical marijuana policy both locally and to set the standard for American society moving forward. Of all the negative consequences of prohibition, none is as tragic as the denial of medicinal marijuana to the tens of thousands of seriously ill patients who could benefit from its use. This includes cancer patients undergoing chemo, AIDS patients suffering from wasting syndromes, and other severe conditions. Currently, Washington's marijuana laws provide a narrow exception to current state laws for those with a qualifying condition. We're now faced with the legislature narrowing that exception even further by imposing greater restrictions on qualifying conditions. Normal's position is that marijuana should be available to anyone who desires it, for holistic health as well as for the palliative healing and long-term treatment of severe chronic conditions. Much of Normal's efforts focus on lobbying both state legislators and Congress. In addition to submitting a paper to the LCB supporting our position to keep home grows and possession limits for patients, providers, and true collectives intact, copies of which are available for you at our table in the lobby. All of our chapter directors have met with and will continue to meet with their representatives. In Seattle, we have our most progressive and receptive constituency in the state, obviously. In Olympia, co-directors of our Thurston County chapter, Rose Eltz and Bailey Hirschberg, have met frequently with state and federal representatives to lobby for their support, including helping to convince our freshman U.S. Congressman Denny Heck to take action on the marijuana banking issue in D.C. In Tacoma and Pierce County, we have Keith Henson. Pierce County is perhaps the most prohibitionist in all of Washington, and Keith has been making progress lobbying state representatives and local council members. And in Spokane, just last week, Washington Normal was invited to speak to state representatives, both Democrats and Republicans, about our legislative priority in the upcoming year, which is to preserve the voter-approved marijuana laws. As the pendulum is swinging from the absence of regulation of the current industry towards the over-regulation of individual patient rights, we must come together to preserve our voter-approved freedoms. We must come together and continue to reach out to our elected officials, pressing them to maintain home grows and possession limits for patients, providers, and true collectives, keeping in mind that the whole world is watching.
Thank you, Kevin Oliver from Washington Normal. Our next speaker is a patient, the founder of the Seattle Hempfest Safety Patrol, and representing also the November Coalition. Give it up to my brother, Kevin Black.
Hi guys, thanks a lot for everybody being here. Since we're on time crunch, I'm gonna keep this really simple. A lot of you probably don't recognize me because you're used to seeing me running around the Hempfest, long hair and everything. Last year, as a matter of fact, yesterday kind of marked the anniversary, I quit chemotherapy. And the only thing that's been keeping me alive is medical cannabis. I'm supposed to be dead by August. So needless to say, leaving our medical laws alone in this state is pretty high on my priority. I'm just going to give you guys one big message here. There's a lot of people here don't get along with everybody, each other, everything. I'm willing to work with every single one of you because we have to fight strong harder. It's going to take every single one of us. I don't care if we've been on opposing sides before. As it stands right now, I'll work with any of you if you're willing to work with me. Like I said, I'm going to keep this short so we have time for more speakers. I'm just going to leave you with my life motto, and it kind of applies here. Could be in dicks to each other.
Kevin Black, Seattle Hempfest. Our next speaker is Dr. Danielle Andreas, Dr. Naturopathy. Dr. Andreas, give a warm hand.
Thank everybody for inviting me today. I just want to give a heartfelt thanks to the 4,000 medical patients I've seen in the last 2 years. It's been an honor to stand witness to your story. You really are truly the only reason I'm standing on this stage today. Quick background. Los Angeles County paramedic. Bachelor's degree in cell and molecular biology, naturopathic doctorate degree from Bastyr, postdoctorate in functional medicine, and I've been practicing functional naturopathic endocrinology for 7 years in Seattle. I really only rattle off all that educational background, one, to lend credibility, but two, to let you know that with all that education, it wasn't until 2011 that I even understood anything medicinally about cannabis. I had no recreational perspective. I was not trained at Bastyr in cannabis. My board exams did not include cannabis, sativa, or indica, although 150 other herbs. And I'm not a medical patient. The seed was planted in 2010 when naturopathic physicians were able to be practitioners added to the list of being able to authorize for the use of medicinal cannabis. This was actually during the busiest time of my practice, and I didn't even consider it for about a year and a half. And then in 2011, I was given the opportunity to work at a clinic doing patient authorizations. It was at that time that I jumped in 100%. It was only 2 weeks of hearing the stories of patients that I knew this was something big, something much larger than myself. I needed to understand this plant completely. I took on hundreds of hours of self-study. I studied thick biochemical books of cannabis. I scoured the medical literature. I listened to lectures of prominent physicians and researchers about cannabis. I gave each and every patient in the room my best, 20 to 40 minutes in the room. I sifted through files, and I'm not kidding, file boxes of medical files, 4 to 5 inches thick of medical records. I'd offer 2 to 5 other treatments in the room other than cannabis based on the condition that they came to me for. I stuck to the list of qualifiable conditions, even though as a doctor, I truly believe that list falls short in our state of Washington. I've seen patients from the age of 18 to 92, comforting them as they cry both in pain and in desperation, not wanting to get high, but just wanting relief. Many have never even tried cannabis recreationally. Wheelbound patients, double prosthetic limbs, IED blasts, severe motor vehicle accidents, broken backs, farming accidents, bodies with more pins, rods, and screws than I care to mention, seizures, cancer, cancer, cancer. I documented each patient's journey meticulously in the medical record. It's the very least that I could do. And most importantly, I documented your words. Cannabis has saved my life. I can't wait to tell you how much better I'm doing this year as they return beaming for a follow-up appointment. I'm back to work after 2 years of my wife being a sole provider, and I've lost 80 pounds. Yes, I hardly recognize you. I'm leaving the house again after being housebound for years. I'm off blank pharmaceutical drugs this year. I can tell you that it's usually 2 to 5. This has been documented, documented, documented. My advanced stage prostate cancer is 98% gone. My urologist has never seen anything like it. This was 40% CBD oil. Thank you for those who are making this miraculous medicine. I just want to end with a few statements and opinions. I believe recreational users are a completely different group from medical patients. We need to maintain a safe and separate system that doesn't hurt anyone. The science says it all. Patients need affordable, tested, pure, free of contaminants medicine. I consider the doctor-patient relationship sacred. What goes on in the room is between us. In my opinion, we need to retain collective gardens and home grows. We need to allow people to be compassionate caregivers. People should be allowed to help people. This is our fundamental need as human beings.
Thank you, Dr. Danielle Andreas. We are running about 30 minutes behind, I apologize for that, but there's so much great content, it's really hard to come out and do the hook on folks. They're saying such important things, so we're just gonna blaze through this. And we've got extra time here today, so I just ask you to be patient, bear with us as we plow through our next second half of speakers.
Thank you.